I want to welcome everyone. Hello, and welcome to Faith in Public Life's second roundtable on the Ohio State Supreme Court. I'm Reverend Dr. Marion Stewart. It is my pleasure to be here and to host this roundtable. I'm the Ohio organizer for Faith in Public Life. Our roundtable is a two-part series focusing on how the state Supreme Court impacts our lives right here in Ohio. Our first roundtable looked at how the state Supreme Court impacted our voting rights. They have huge impact on our voting rights. And today we're also focusing again on the state Supreme Court, but its impact on comprehensive reproductive health care and rights right here in Ohio. So, roundtables, these are important. You get information that you can use because we all need to make informed voting decisions, including all the way down the ballot. Don't leave those candidate blanks or blanks because these are important and they impact our lives. These roundtables are designed as C3 nonpartisan space, and they're packed with information. So take note however you want to, and you can use that to inform your decisions. At Faith in Public Life, our mission is to advance the moral imperative for just, inclusive, and equitable countries so that everyone can live into their full humanity. We work with faith and community leaders to take transformative action. With a faith-forward strategy, we help build cultures of belonging and leverage the collective power of multi-faith and multi-racial coalition to lead us closer to realizing a healthy and equitable democracy. I want to thank our co-sponsors, Common Good and Red, Wine, and Blue. Both organizations center the importance of our full participation to make democracy as healthy and fair as possible for all Ohioans. Our hope is that you'll leave here today with increased understanding of the Ohio State Supreme Court's decisions and how they impact our lives. We hope you hear a few real stories of impact. And also understand and know that your vote is important, including and especially including those judicial positions for the state Supreme Court. Basically, your vote matters. Plan wisely and vote. So let's back up a minute. If you've ever wondered if the Ohio State Supreme Court has impact on your life, here are a few of the recent decisions. Chicken wings advertised as boneless can indeed have bones. Disabled voters who need assistance now have more difficulty accessing ballot drop boxes. And the Supreme Court approved controversial language on the Citizens Not Politicians ballot initiative. Other decisions affect everything from Ohio's access to comprehensive reproductive health care to the death penalty. How we vote helps determine who makes these decisions. So let's unpack some of the Ohio basics. And Mia is our tech person. I'm going to ask her to share a screen with a hierarchy of our Ohio state government structure. That should appear on your screen. There we go. So what you see here is a chart of how our government structure. The boxes in orange indicate offices that reflect democracy right here in Ohio. In the top box, you'll see the people of Ohio. That's us. We get to vote for who fills all the rest of the jobs. The state Supreme Court is on the right under judicial branch. Since it's important to note too, since 2021, all judicial candidates must declare party affiliation. It appears next to their name on the ballot. And believe me, that has totally impacted the races. You'll also often hear seemingly random decisions issued by the Ohio State Supreme Court, but they are all connected within this whole system. So all these politics, back and forth depend on how we vote. This determines who holds these positions and how these decisions come show up in our lives. So if anybody wants a copy of this, I'll be happy to send it to them. But this is how we operate here in the state and Supreme Court. They really, really impact us. So make sure you vote and vote wisely. And thank you, Mia, for that. So we've gathered quite a panel today for you. I'd like to start with panelist introductions. I'm going to start with someone who hasn't quite joined us yet. We hope she will. Dr. Cynthia Tyson. Dr. Cynthia Tyson is a professor of Department of Teaching and Learning at the Ohio State University. Her research and scholarship interests include teaching for social justice, early childhood social studies, and multicultural children's literature. Dr. Tyson also has interest in the examination of race and racism in her research. She has presented numerous papers at national meetings and conferences and has published articles in multiple books and journals. Dr. Tyson's work is both nationally and internationally recognized. She has worked in a consulting capacity with school districts across the nation, the United Kingdom, Mali, West Africa, and is currently collaborating with teachers and researchers on a project in Johannesburg, South Africa. We hope to welcome Dr. Tyson shortly. She will just join us, but we have her introduction. And Lauren Balvet, Planned Parenthood Advocates of Ohio. She is the executive director, and she's been with Planned Parenthood for almost 15 years. Starting as an intern and then organizer in Southwest Ohio, and then a state field director. Lauren directs policy, advocacy, and communications for both Ohio Planned Parenthood affiliates and all electoral campaigns for Planned Parenthood Votes Ohio. Lauren led the victorious Reproductive Rights Ballot Initiative as co-chair for Ohioans United for Reproductive Rights, secured abortion rights in the Ohio Constitution in 2023, which I will note is still playing out in the Ohio State Supreme Court. But for her leadership, Lauren was named Time Magazine's 100 Most Influential People in the World for 2024. So congratulations, Lauren. That's awesome. And so glad you're here. And we have Kelly Copeland. Kelly has served as executive director of Abortion Forward since 2002. In her fight to protect reproductive freedom in Ohio, she has been quoted in every major Ohio media outlet and has testified in over 40 anti-abortion hearings. With a degree from the University of Akron, her career includes working for the AFL-CIO and presidential and national party campaigns. She has held appointments in the U.S. Department of Education, the Summit County Board of Elections, and the City of Talmadge. Kelly also serves as deaconess and treasurer for First Grace United Church of Christ in Akron. Welcome, Kelly. And Dr. Ben Hillskamp. Ben is with Love Boldly, and with over 13 years of leadership in nonprofit and educational spaces, the Reverend Dr. Bill Hillskamp, is Executive Director of Love Boldly and pastor of Blue Ocean Faith Columbus. He is an active author, speaker, consultant, and researcher interested in the intersection of faith, sexuality, gender, and race, as well as leadership broadly. Welcome, Ben. And we have Jean Perez. Jen is a State Program Director for Red, Wine, and Blue, Ohio, a community of women standing up to extremism in our local communities and across our state. Jen worked in the corporate world, but when the U.S. Supreme Court decided Dobbs, she looked at her own life experiences and decided to work for issues that mattered to all Ohioans. So welcome, Jen, and welcome everyone to our roundtable. So let's see. We have first questions here, and we will ask Dr. Tyson when she gets here her question about some of the governance structure, because she loves to teach, and we will let her teach us shortly. So, Lauren, we're going to start off with you. Lauren, again, is with Planned Parenthood. So Planned Parenthood has been a decades-long leader for comprehensive reproductive rights in healthcare. Planned Parenthood not only provides a wide range of services, it also serves as a leading advocate. As such, you are in the know about relevant legal issues. Can you give us some insight about how we got to where we are in Ohio?
Absolutely. Thank you, Marian. It's great to be here with this awesome panel. So good afternoon, everyone. Yeah, I have the kind of the hard start of how did we get here? Because none of this happened by accident. What we saw starting after 2010 was a very purposeful attack on abortion access and reproductive health care that led to the passage of 31 abortion bans and restrictions. So something that's important to know about those 31 abortion bans and restrictions is they were all passed while we still had the federal protection of Roe v. Wade. So it's important that, you know, while Roe was protection that we were able to hold on to while it was in place, it kept the most egregious total bans from going into effect, that there were several restrictions that were completely medically unnecessary and significant burdens both to patients and providers that became law here in Ohio. And then, of course, we lost Roe in the Dobbs decision. And immediately, the same day that Dobbs fell, by 3 p.m., abortion providers in Ohio had to stop providing care. We had to cancel appointments. We had to face immediately Ohio patients who were expecting to get the abortion care that they needed, that they would no longer be able to get in their state. For 11 weeks, we weren't able to provide abortion to patients who needed it. And we saw firsthand that about half of our patients, even with a strong infrastructure and a strong support that we got from organizations like Abortion Forward and Red, Wine, and Blue, Love Boldly, all of our, like, everybody was trying to help, whether it was funding, emotional support, Faith in Public Life, like showing up, and many organizations that aren't here, and providers and supporters. We had infrastructure that was intended to help patients get to states where they could receive care. They couldn't afford it. It was childcare, their ability to be off work. Some folks had never traveled outside of their community. It was just too much to go to a state. So even though there were states where it was legal, half of the people during those 11 weeks were forced to continue pregnancies that they did not want to. So it was essential that that ban be blocked. And we found that in a Hamilton County justice judge in after that 11 weeks. But we knew collectively that we could not have an abortion ban here in Ohio. So the hard work of putting together a ballot initiative, which frankly started a long time before that in all of our investment and our organizing and our partnership, many years of planning to ensure that we could have a ballot initiative went into it. And we did. We turned around a very quick campaign for 2023 that ultimately protected abortion access through the Ohio Reproductive Freedom Amendment. And now we have a constitutional amendment that protects abortion access. And yet we still have those 31 abortion bans and restrictions. Now, the 6-week ban has been, is blocked. We anticipate it will be permanently blocked. But a lot of those medically unnecessary laws are still in place. They can only change through the legislature, which is not going to do it, or through litigation. So Planned Parenthood is in partnership with the ACLU and Case Western to continue to litigate all of these restrictions. They're necessary. It's the only way that we're going to be able to have more bring back more abortion providers or ensure that our patients are able to get the full amount of care that they need is to ensure that we have Ohio Supreme Court that is going to listen to the people and is going to make judgments that is true to the language in the Ohio Reproductive Freedom Amendment and make sure that access is a reality for everyone. We have to ensure that it's different than it was under Roe. Under Roe, abortion was a right, but it was largely inaccessible to most people. What we have the opportunity under the Ohio Reproductive Freedom Amendment is to have access for Ohioans and our and patients in neighboring states, but only if the Ohio Supreme Court judges listen to the Constitution, respect the Constitution, and listen to the people. So it's so important who is in the Ohio Supreme Court and the decisions that they're about to make on reproductive health care.
Wow, that's a lot. Thanks, Lauren. Appreciate your answer there. And welcome, Dr. Tyson. So glad you're here and could join us. I gave your introduction just a few moments ago, so I want to back up and ask you a question. You just heard Lauren's answer, so you're a respected educator and leader, and maybe some of your wisdom on our Ohio State Supreme Court. Can you tell our audience how are laws challenged, access laws, things like that for reproductive health care? How are they challenged into the state Supreme Court? How do they get there? Once a decision is made by the Ohio State Supreme Court, is that the final say? Is there a way to challenge their decision? How does this work in Ohio for people who maybe aren't quite as familiar with our judicial system? Can you help us out here?
Well, that's a big question. I apologize
yeah.
for my tardiness tied up on another issue. Well, I think that one of the things that I often, especially in this education role, is to help people understand how the Ohio State Supreme Court even gets to where they are. You know, there's often ways in which people totally are blindsided by the big elections, right? So we have the presidential election that's happening. People are very much involved in that. I get that. But they don't always understand who is not only who's in the legislative roles at the state level that will be making the kinds of decisions to either implement what is the will of the people or not. In Ohio, there was a vote that made it an amendment to the constitutional to uphold reproductive justice and reproductive rights as a part of a woman's right to have bodily autonomy and to choose. But what we're seeing now is that at the federal level, we're having conversations about how that would be ignored. And then we would have this federal constitution, I mean, this federal edict that says, okay, we're going to now ban all of these things. And I lean not into just abortion. I always want to expand the conversation to reproductive rights, to the ways in which bodily autonomy is a right to every person, and especially to women as they make choices about their own bodies. So again, that being registered to vote, getting out to vote, paying attention to who are not only at the state level, Supreme Court level, but also the folks who are judges, people who are in policymaking positions, because often those folks then also set into motion who gets appointed to some of the state level and community level facilities that have to carry these things out. I don't pretend to be at all an expert on the ways in which the legislature operates, and I encourage people to do that research. But we often forget that there is this chain of power, and with that power comes the privilege to be able to make those kinds of decisions. So I'm not quite sure that I answered everything that you might have wanted to hear in that answer, but I think the one thing that people can do is empower themselves to do the research, see who is running for the offices, support the candidates that align as best they possibly can with what they believe. There are no perfect candidates. And if we're looking for someone to totally align with everything we believe and everything we want and dream and hope for in the world, that's not going to happen. But to find the folks that align with the things that are of most importance to us, and then vote those people in office and recognizing that empowering that vote is the way to make the biggest impact of change.
Thank you. Couple follow-ups here. There's a question in the chat about the Ohio State Supreme Court positions open. Are they open this election? Yes, they are. I think three are open, three seats are open. If so, who are those who are sensitive to this issue in a positive way? I wanna note this is C3 space. We can't recommend candidates by name, but maybe if you listen here, you can go do some research, and later on and someone's answer, maybe you could give a resource that people might be able to go to look for helpful answers there. And Dr. Tyson, one follow-up question here for you. If the Supreme Court, whether U.S. or Ohio, but specifically Ohio, makes a decision that the voters don't like, is there direct recourse back to the Supreme Court, some judicial mechanism that we can challenge a decision, or do we have to do like we did and go to the streets, get signatures, and launch an initiative?
Unmute myself. And, you know, maybe some of my other colleagues on this call could also offer something there. You know, there is an appeal process. There's what they call the petition, 90 days after a judgment that can happen. You know, and I really encourage people to, in terms of being able to file, if there is a filing petition that they want to move forward with, that they figure, you know, go and research all of that. I don't want to give misinformation. You know, we got enough of that floating around. There are things, you know, a process that can ask, that could be a petition that would ask for their referendum to sort of, you know, have that appeal happen. It has happened in the past. The ruling can be challenged. I think if I'm put this hat on, and please check this, fact check me here, that 2/3 of both the House and the Congress, in order to propose an amendment, you know, to the Constitution, and then that referendum happens in terms of court rulings and overruling that. There's an appellate process that can happen if one does not agree. And I'm going to stop there because I don't, like I said, give misinformation. I would ask people to Google that, you know, because Google is our friend. But, you know, the primary means to petition a court for a review is, you know, to ask what they call it. I'm going to say it wrong. A writ of certiorari. I'll put it in the chat, but there is a process for that. And if you Google this and look, then you'll be able to see how to move forward with that.
Thank you, Dr. Tyson. I didn't know that. I didn't know we had 90 days to actually respond to a ruling, that it's not final really until after that 90 days passes, so that no challenges are made. So anyone who doesn't like anyone or any group that has standing can potentially file a complaint through this process. And yes, thank you so much. That was very helpful. And our next question is for Kelly. Kelly, an Ohio State University study published Monday in JAMA Pediatrics found that the U.S. more U.S. babies have died. They've died at a higher rate than expected in the months after the U.S. Supreme Court decision that overturned Roe v. Wade. The Columbus Dispatch reports that during that time, there was a 7% increase in infant mortality and a 10% increase in babies born with abnormalities. These numbers, they're awful. They're like heartbreaking. These are real stories, real people. They're not just statistics. Can you tell us if there are any challenges to last year's passage of Issue 1 that have made their way into the state Supreme Court that have hampered or impacted full access to reproductive health care here in Ohio? And could you give us an example if you have one?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, I want to start by saying that the study in JAMA really shows what advocates for the full range of reproductive health care have been saying for a long time, which is the government being involved in health care decisions never makes things better. Often it makes it worse. Sometimes it criminalizes people. Sometimes it results in heartbreaking situations, as was found in this study. I think what also has happened in Ohio is that we have fewer OBGYNs, and that affects access not just to abortion, but to pre and postnatal care, to some, you know, cancer treatments for people who get cancer in their reproductive health care organs. You know, the impact on these restrictions is felt by every community. We have places in Ohio where you can't deliver a baby because there's no doctor there, because they've left the state. And so when the government is politicizes reproductive health care, there will be bad outcomes, and many of them will be heartbreaking. So I want to start by saying that. I also think that, you know, yes, there are some cases working their way to the state Supreme Court that impact this. Obviously, the 6-week ban, which is basically a near total ban, you know, when people are not able to take action that is right for them and their families, that's right for them medically, you know, these sorts of things can happen. There's also a 24-hour waiting period that requires 2 visits that is very detrimental to access to reproductive health care. Many people just cannot get past those hurdles. And sometimes that means people continuing a pregnancy against their will or against medical advice. And, you know, so those cases are going to come before that state Supreme Court. And as Lauren mentioned, you know, the state Supreme Court that we have now, there are 7 members, as someone asked, there are 3 members up for reelection. 2 of them are incumbents. One of the seats is open because the person who holds that is challenging another incumbent, which is pretty tacky if you ask me. But, you know, this is a nonpartisan space, so that's all I'm going to say about that. But what I will say about the boneless chicken case, what it shows is that the majority on this case, I mean, we can all chuckle about that and how ridiculous it sounds, but what it shows is there is a majority on this court that is starting with the outcome that they want and working their way back to create a decision that supports that. Instead of starting with the law, and in this case, we're talking about the Ohio Reproductive Freedom Amendment, which was passed by 57% of Ohioans. Clearly, the values of Ohio, the law that was enacted by the people who are the ultimate lawmakers in the state. And that is what's so concerning about what will happen at the state Supreme Court, because if they're willing to redefine a common term like boneless chicken wing, what are they going to do with medical terms that are in the Ohio Reproductive Freedom Amendment? What would they do to come up with the outcome that they want on these cases that is political, that is ideological, and not just following the law? And I think that that is what's so disturbing. I also think that one of the things I did, I always do this to prepare when I vote. I go to the website of my county board of elections, and you can see what's going to be on your ballot before you go in to vote. And I found that the Ohio Supreme Court is actually the second thing on the ballot. There's president, and then there's the 3 seats for Ohio Supreme Court, and then Senate and other races. I encourage you, if you feel, because I know a lot of people will skip a race if they don't feel like they know enough about it. And I encourage you to take some time, just a few minutes, get online, look at what your newspaper says about the candidates for the state Supreme Court or organizations that you trust to see if they've made recommendations so that you can go in and make a fully informed decision about that race, because the future of the Ohio Reproductive Freedom Amendment really depends on what the state Supreme Court makeup looks like. Will it be a majority that follows the law and applies the law? Or will it be a majority who is willing to redefine common terms to come up with an outcome regardless of the law? And I think that that is really the central issue in this race. And I think on the federal level, looking at candidates for Senate, for president, for Congress, you know, there's a lot of talk about a national ban on abortion. And if that happened, it would supersede the Ohio Reproductive Freedom Amendment. So those are 2 of the biggest threats to that law being enacted. And of course, the final one, as Lauren mentioned, you know, we can't go through the legislature to repeal the restrictions on abortion. It's not because that's not possible. It's because those districts have been gerrymandered. And that has created a manufactured anti-abortion majority, a supermajority even, which you see is out of touch with Ohio values. You look at how people voted on issue 1 last year, and you look at our legislature, and you can see that something doesn't add up. So this year's issue 1 gives voters an opportunity to say, no more gerrymandering. We want districts that represent us. And those are really the 3 ways that people who want to ensure that they have access to the reproductive health care they need can take action on the ballot this year.
Thank you, Kelly. Wow, that was a lot of information between you and Laura and Dr. Tyson. You just rock. Thank you so much. Wow. Ben, you're up. Got a question for you. While the Constitution declares separation of church and state, I also want to acknowledge that we each come to the table with a set of values and morals often rooted in generational wisdom and faith traditions. So I want to engage you right now as a pastor. Can you share how the challenges to comprehensive reproductive health care show up in pastoral situations? What is the impact on the ground? What comes to you as a pastor?
Sure. Thank you, Marion. I would start out by saying and really acknowledging that while I come at this as a pastor out of the Christian tradition, faith traditions across the board are not in total agreement on issues, or even within one religion, Christianity being a good example, on the issue of reproductive care and of abortion. I think the one way that I see it showing up the most in pastoral conversations, again, like you said, on the ground, is really chilling the climate for people to engage in comprehensive decision-making about their reproductive care, whether that be a choice or a discernment around whether or not one seeks abortion care or other reproductive care, how one decides to handle a pregnancy. We see time and again decisions, debates that are being held at a governmental level rather than at a personal level, really chilling the overall conversation, really making people question, can I even go to my pastor about this? Can I go to people in my spiritual community or my faith community about these questions? Particularly when those communities are already charged themselves around the issues of reproductive freedom and bodily autonomy. Now, I would say going a bit beyond that, whenever we see legitimate medical care, which abortion is, challenged, we also see other forms of legitimate medical care challenged as well. But a lot of my work, quite frankly, is with the queer community. So when we see abortion rights and reproductive freedoms and bodily autonomy challenged, we also see gender-affirming care challenged. It's not a coincidence that we see challenges to both types of, again, legitimate care showing up together. I would also, kind of echoing what Dr. Tyson said, I would also broaden this to include how our faith shows up when we're talking about overall bodily autonomy, how we're showing up, how our faith tells us to show up in spaces as people, again, from my Christian tradition, created in the image and likeness of God. And again, speaking from a Christian tradition, Jesus never talks about abortion. The Bible maybe has one passage that talks about abortion and actually gives steps to someone about how to have an abortion. These are simply not things that are considered in Christianity, in other faith traditions. They've been co-opted largely by Christian nationalists to appear to be a Christian issue when they are an issue that should be left not to the government, not to the people who shout the loudest in faith, but rather be considered only between a woman or someone else who is able to be pregnant, their and anyone else that they include, whether that's their family, their God, their spiritual background. It really should always be that personal consideration, that personal choice, and who that person's bringing into the conversation. I hope that answers the question.
That's awesome, Ben. And yes, so we think about, a lot of times when we think about comprehensive reproductive health care, we think just of abortion, but the topic is huge. It's comprehensive. It impacts, you step out from there and you can go right on keeping on stepping out to how people with power want to control our bodies. And that gets into all sorts of quagmires, if you will, and a lot of harm against whole groups of people. And we have a lot of history around that. So thank you for that and for everyone for real impact stories. And speaking of impact, Jen, you have an impact story. So not long ago, you made a decision that changed like your whole life. Yeah. Can you share with us some more about how a court decision set your life on a new course? And how do you not just see the role of Ohio State Supreme Court and our access to reproductive health care in a comprehensive way, but also the importance of informed voting? Can you help us out on that? Share your story.
Sure. Thanks, Marion. So like Marion said, you know, a couple of years ago, I would have never considered myself political. And in early 2022, I was working a big corporate job at a company that I had spent almost 20 years at. It was kind of the only thing I knew. And when the Dobbs decision came down, I felt this like very strong sense that I needed to do something. And so I actually started a whole new chapter in my life, walked away from the only career I had ever known, and started getting into this work related to issues that really matter here in Ohio. And I think, like so many women in this country, I have a personal connection to various forms of reproductive health care throughout my life. I've used birth control not only to decide if and when to have and grow a family, but also suffered from years of undiagnosed endometriosis. So the birth control helped with my symptoms. We used fertility treatments, dealt with multiple miscarriages, abortion, kind of like the whole gamut of reproductive health care throughout my lifetime. And I just, like I said, I just, that one decision, I was like, this can't be the world that we live in. And I know there are people, you know, Kelly, Lauren, so many people who have been working this for years and fighting this fight for years. But that court decision is really what helped me to shift and say, like, I got to get in this fight as well. And I think last year with issue one, we heard similar stories from individuals across the state where they became motivated and more active, paying more attention. I know it within Red, Wine, and Blue, our members and volunteers, we had women collecting signatures who had never, some of them never even signed a petition before. And they were out there, you know, talking to strangers about this super important issue. So I think that even though the Dobbs decision was over 2 years ago, people have not forgotten the impact of this decision, especially when we are seeing some of these reports coming out, like Kelly mentioned, with data around what is happening in these states where these bans are getting put in place. But especially here in Ohio, you know, last year's constitutional amendment that we passed to protect reproductive freedom, it really created conversations in places where some of those conversations weren't being had and allowed women and men, everyone, to learn that it wasn't just abortion rights that we need to protect. It's the full gamut of reproductive health care. So I hope that answers your first question. Your second question was asking about informed voting. And I think this is so important, especially this year in Ohio. Again, kind of thinking back to a couple years ago myself, like I totally get it. We all have lives. We are all busy. We all have friends who are not on a noon round table talking about the Ohio Supreme Court. And it can be easy for people to not feel informed enough to fill in every little square on their ballot and skip over some of the elections that they see. There was a sister district report that showed that amongst men, 81% of them vote all the way down ballot. But amongst women, it's only 68%. So, you know, a lot of women are very activated by this reproductive rights fight. And so really working to make sure that not only we as voters, but the people that we know, friends and family, know how to vote all the way down ballot, not just like who's at the top of the ticket. So what else did I want to say? Oh, Marion, you mentioned that it was 2021 when our Supreme Court races became partisan. And one thing that I recently learned is that it's actually only 8 states in the country who have partisan elections for Supreme Court. So, you know, it is new in Ohio. Some people won't appreciate that that isn't how it's always been. I mean, I'm finding that some of my friends in Ohio don't even know that we elect our Supreme Court candidates. So again, as far as like being an informed voter, it's kind of what I tell people is you need to be informed yourself and then take it to the next level and make sure all your friends are informed as well. It's one thing to say like, oh, I'm ready to go vote all the way up and down the ballot, but how can we all help the people that we interact with every day to make sure they are also fully informed?
Thank you, Jen. Yes, you did answer my questions. And back to the 2021 decision to make, to require that judicial candidates declare their political party affiliation, there was an immediate impact on the makeup of the courts.
Yeah. Yes.
So it is so important to vote all the way down the ballot. And Jen, that's a shocking statistic that 68% of women do not vote down ballot. I did not know that. That's just appalling. So everybody pay attention. And I see in the chat, there's all sorts of resources for doing some homework to looking into who's running for which enriched race. And there's all sorts, if you just look over the chat, there's a lot of guides and references there. While I look at the chat for some more questions, I want to open it up to the panel. Do you have questions of each other? Did anything come up that you would like to know more about, or?
I don't have a question. I don't know if anybody else does, but I do have a real quick statement that I'd like to make.
Uh-huh.
And that is for helping us historicize this. This is not new. The ways in which marginalized groups across our existence here in the U.S. has had, you know, these sorts of challenges. I mean, we can look at the Tuskegee experiment, penicillin being held from Black men who were allowed to die, forced sterilizations all throughout the South of women, Black and brown women without their consent. We look at the HIV/AIDS epidemic and when it happened, and LGBTQIA populations were not given the resources were not there. And then we look at infant mortality right now within Black and brown communities and how women in those groups are health. I mean, the disparity for death and childbirth. So the ways in which we approach this, and I do this educationally, is first of all to let people know this is not new. The ways in which people's health care connected to bodily autonomy and oppression through legislature is not new, and through institutions and systems. What is new is that because we have not kept ourselves educated about it, is that we sometimes then don't read down the ballot. And so as my colleague said here, yes, each one teach one is a phrase I always use. If you tell one person and teach that one person about voting down and reading down the ballot, then challenge that person to tell one more person, and then that person to tell one more person, so that the educational chain can continue to help people understand how really important it is to not only vote, but to pay attention to down the ballot and what that is going to mean.
Dr. Tyson, I love that. You are an educator through and through, and your statement, reach one, teach one, I think we can all go for that. If somebody could type that in the chat real quick, or Dr. Tyson, somebody, reach one, teach one, I think that's just a go-to motto that is so easy to do. And yes, putting it into historical context is so important because we're fighting for these issues today, but we easily see the long tail of just challenges to bodily autonomy throughout all of American history. It touches on every aspect of everything. So thank you so much. And anybody else have a question for each other? Otherwise, I have a quick question for you all.
I just wanted to second what Dr. Tyson said. And, you know, one of the things that we hear kind of along those lines for some people who've been involved in the fight for a long time are, I can't believe I still have to do this. And, you know, I just want to recognize for some people, you know, like Jen, you know, maybe they're newer to the work, and that's incredible. That is so needed to build the critical mass that we need to make sure that everyone can get the care that they need without stigma, judgment, delay, financial barriers. But I think, you know, we also need people who have been doing the work for a long time to, you know, take care of themselves and to be able, so they can continue to be able to fight. And, you know, some of our supporters, when they say, I can't believe I still have to do this, kind of the question I ask them is like, well, under what circumstances would you surrender? There are none. There are no circumstances under which I would surrender. I know what access to reproductive health care has meant for my family. I had a great grandmother who, obviously, at the time they didn't have birth control. She had 21 children that lived. They lived in abject poverty. I had a grandmother who had an illegal abortion because, you know, she wasn't healthy enough to continue a pregnancy. You know, I've, you know, benefited from birth control myself. I mean, in what universe would I ever give that up for my girls? You know, they're in their 20s, and I know what a difference just generationally it means for families to be able to access the care that they need. And so I just wanted to share that, like, you know, whether you're new to this fight and, you know, and you get weary, or you've been in this fight for a long time and you get weary, what you're fighting for is absolutely worth it. Don't let anyone tell you that it's hopeless, because it never has been.
That's awesome. Thank you for amplifying what each other is saying. All your stories and your comments have worked, just, they're seamless. It's all of a piece, right? We have to work together. I'm also reading Timothy Snyder's new book on freedom, and he talks about freedom is not just running from something, putting something down or away, or not dealing with it, but freedom is actually going for something. Working for something. So a real quick, just a few words or one statement answer. If you could do anything for comprehensive reproductive health care, what would be your priority to work for that? What would be your priority for what one thing would you work on to make it happen? What would that be?
I think for me, it all rests on stigma. Mm-hmm. You know, the callousness that sometimes we bring to judging the decisions that other people make is so harmful. And I think, you know, if I could do one thing, I would eliminate stigma, and I would make understanding and empathy for each other universal.
I love that. Anyone else? One word.
I love that answer too. Through litigation, I would change how abortion providers are classified. They're wrongfully classified right now in a way that makes it easier to restrict and keep us from being able to, like, open our doors. So I think something that people rightfully expect is that we should be able to have more abortion providers. And if we get rid of a couple more of those restrictions, then we'll be able to really flourish and increase access.
Ah, that's a very insightful goal there. Thank you. Anyone else?
I think I'd get some billboards, right? I need some money, right? Get some billboards that would just say to people, reproductive justice is more than abortion.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe another billboard. Reproductive justice is about all aspects of what it means to have bodily autonomy about reproductive, your body, you know, so that people can broaden the conversation. Way too many times do I hear people just conflating it to being about abortion without understanding that, yes, every part of a woman's body that is attached to what it means to be reproductive, whether she is deciding to have children or not, she is deserving of the kind of healthcare that gives her the right to make the choices. If that's care for abortion, if that's birth control, if that's endometriosis care, if it's care, you know, for cervical cancer. I mean, people don't understand that it's all of those parts and pieces. So I know that was a long way around the answer, but yeah.
That's awesome. It's also a billboard that reproductive health care, it matters who rules your body. And we do, right? We should. But you got to vote. Anyone else before we go on? I'm watching the clock too. So, Ben?
I would say developing, at least for me, developing more male allies, men as allies, but not just on the understanding of like, oh, we all have mothers and sisters and friends, blah, 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 but actually developing men who, instead of being part of the problem, are actively demonstrating and standing up and showing up with women to argue and to agitate for more reproductive justice.
Awesome. We'll go for that. Thank you. Jen, you got anything before we close out?
I think just seconding what Kelly said, my initial thought was like just understanding, like more understanding and empathy. There's like some, you know, disinformation that's spread about what abortion care is and what it looks like. And just, yeah, increasing the understanding, the empathy around all of the reproductive health care that we're talking about here.
Perfect. I'm watching the chat. Thank you for keeping up with it, Jen. I see you're going back and forth on a few things. Thank you. And thank you, Dr. Tyson, for being in there. We have one thing. I wish that we could describe this issue in the broader sense to reflect the issue of women's right to decide what is best for her health and the family in conjunction with her own physician. Yes. I'm a person of faith. Amen to that. So there we go. I want to close our conversation today, but we've got a few important things to close out with. Our court, who we vote for, it really, really, really matters. So please pay attention, do your research. Yes, not just this election, but all elections, and pay attention to in-between elections. But I want to lift up that the League of Women Voters is running social media ads that rightly claim that if you don't use your voice, someone else will use your silence. If you don't use your voice, someone else will use your silence. So in 2020, more than 1 million Ohio voters left the state Supreme Court races blank. 1 million blanks. So I'm going to turn it over to Jen. And Jen, where are we in the voting stage? And Mia, I think we have Kayla's graph from last roundtable you might want to put up. But Jen, what do we do?
Yeah.
Where are we?
So voting started a few weeks ago here in Ohio. And basically every week that goes by, we get more and more hours and more opportunities to vote early. So these next two weekends, starting Saturday, we have early voting from 8 to 4 on Saturdays and 1 to 5 on Sundays. So early voting is such a great option because you never know what's going to happen on election day. You could wake up sick, like the most sick you've ever felt in your life. You could have a car accident, like all these unexpected things could pop up. So I know one thing we've been talking about is just like, can you find time to go vote early? And I dropped a link earlier, voteohio.gov. It has like your polling locations, the early voting hours. Another thing that's super helpful is actually downloading your sample ballot. I think we mentioned this already, but you can download it, fill it out, know exactly who you want to vote for, take the time to do research, look things up on your computer or your phone, and then you can just take those papers right in the voting booth with you. You could also save it onto your phone. You can have your phone in with you when you're voting. So definitely looking at your sample ballot especially helps with those down ballot races, some of like your county commissioner or prosecutor, things like that. If you're not interested in voting early, you can request your mail-in ballots for a few more days. We're recommending to request those by tomorrow, the 25th at the latest, just so that there's time for them to be mailed to you. And then to return those, you either are going to return it in person or by mail leading up to the election. And then obviously November 5th is election day. Polls across the state are open from 6:30 a.m. to 7:30 p.m. You can find your polling location on that voteohio.gov website, or you can just Google, like, where will I be voting? And you'd be able to find your location. A couple other things I want to point out. We do have new voter ID laws in Ohio. So if you aren't aware of those, make sure you look for that as well. But you will need valid, unexpired form of ID to vote in person. So make sure you have that with you. And then just remember, on election day, if you are in line to vote, stay in line. Do not leave your polling location until you have cast your ballot, even if you need to cast a provisional ballot for some reason. So that's kind of where we're at. We've got a couple more days until the election ends. Like I told a friend of mine the other day, she was like, oh, election day's coming up. And I was like, election day is when the election ends. We're in the middle of it right now. People are out there voting. So like, even when we talk about being an informed voter and like maybe talking to your friend or your neighbor about the election, like now is the time to do it. Don't wait until November 4th or 5th, because that's really when our election ends, is on the 5th. So definitely download your sample ballot, do your research, and be ready to go. And then take that extra step to reach at least one more person in your circle, someone that you talk to on a regular basis. I know one thing that's been in my social media feed is people are saying like, hey, let me know how you plan to vote. And people are commenting and talking about, oh, I'm going this weekend, or I'm voting on election day, and just like helping people drop like, okay, go get your sample ballot and stuff. So that's how we can all make an impact bigger than just like our vote, which is our voice, but kind of make it bigger by talking to other people about it.
Great. Thank you, Jen. And reach one, teach one from Dr. Tyson. There we go. Word from the educator, reach one, teach one. Also, your digital driver's license does not work. You must have the physical driver's license for your ID. So just a reminder there for those who are tech savvy, take the real thing. And in closing, I want to thank everybody for the panelists for sharing your wisdom, attendees for not just being here, but also answering questions and making the chat live place for resourcing. I want to thank our co-sponsors, Common Cause and Red Wine and Blue. Yay. And this has been recorded, so it will show up later on YouTube under Faith in Public Life. We will also send out a link for all those who registered, so that you can share it broadly with your friends and community and networks. So that's awesome there. Bottom line is, pay attention. Who you vote for matters. Your vote matters. So plan wisely and vote. So thank you all very much for being here. Thank you, panelists. And just, yeah, we'll do this again. But thank you. We'll see you on the other side of the elections. Thank you all. Bye-bye.